Hi, I'm Pia. I'm an economic researcher and I teach macroeconomics. In this video, we're going to learn about long-run production and the role and determinants of productivity. In order to do so, we're going to start by defining what is the long run in macroeconomics. Then we are going to review the concept of economic growth as well as its main drivers. This will allow us to do a small review on the Solow-Swan model on economic growth and the role of productivity. And finally, we'll analyze which are the determinants of productivity. Productivity is related to what we call long-run production. How can we define long-run production? The first thing that we have to keep in mind is price flexibility. Price flexibility is not the same for all goods and services. That is why, in macroeconomics, we use an assumption in order to simplify and establish the difference between the short run and the long run. This assumption consists on the fact that the prices of final products sold to consumers are more flexible than input prices. In other words, the cost of each factor of production used to produce a final good or service is more inflexible in the short term than the price of the final good itself. What's the most common example? Wages. Wages are the payments for labor, which is an input used for most final products. Wages have two main qualities. They are adjusted periodically and not automatically, and they have downward inflexibility, which means as they adjust, they are unlikely to be reduced. Those qualities are significantly different from final products, which can adjust their prices more quickly. So the short run consists on the time horizon over which the wages and prices of other inputs to production are inflexible. Within this time frame, it is assumed that there may be imbalances. Some prices may have adjusted to changes in market conditions, those of the final products, while others have not, those of the inputs. And the long run consists on the period of time over which these input prices have time to adjust. In this case, the overall price level, contractual wage rates, and expectations are fully adjusted in equilibrium, which allows us to make analysis regarding GDP and general prices. Now that we understand the concept of long run, let's see how that applies to economic growth. Economic growth is defined by an increase in the market value of the goods and services that an economy produces over time. It is measured as a percentage rate in the real gross domestic product. Why real domestic product? Because this indicator seeks to capture whether there is genuine growth in the total output by isolating the impact of inflation. So, one country can experience economic growth from one year to another. That is, if the real GDP has increased over a certain period of time. However, if you want to talk about the long run, this growth has to occur long enough for all prices to adjust. So long-run economic growth consists on a sustained rise in the quantity of goods and services that an economy produces. Many economists theorize about what makes an economy grow in a sustained manner. Among the main debates, we can extract three main factors. First of all, growth of productivity. It is associated to the availability of physical capital or the fact that the cost of products decreases as production rises. In other words, the optimization or minimization of the cost related to the inputs. Secondly, demographic changes. The population structure can be crucial. For example, a higher educated population can lead to higher industrialization and higher GDP. It is also important to keep in mind the ratio between demographic growth and the availability of natural resources. Finally, the labor force participation or the size of its workforce. Sustainable growth requires an equilibrium between these factors. Each factor is not always enough. For example, when population growth is the only factor driving GDP growth, rather than changes in supply, demand, or revenue, the growth can be excessive. An economy must satisfy the demands of the population in order to succeed. Supply, demand, revenue, and employment. Where demographic expansion is higher than the employment reaction rate, for example, the economy is unable to keep up, leading to higher unemployment rates and eventually worse standards of living. Now it's time for a quick exercise. A country that produces vaccines has achieved sustainable economic growth. It is known that the government has subsidized machinery that makes production more efficient, since it allows to produce more vaccines per hour and per worker. Which driver is boosting economic growth? If you answer productivity growth, you are correct. Remember, investments on technology that increase productivity can be a key incentive for economic growth. Let's focus on the first driver, productivity growth. The Solow-Swan model is the basic step towards this. This model is a first approach to analyze variables that affect economic growth. As a consequence, it analyzes variations in GDP over time. Economic growth can be associated to many factors, as we have seen previously. This model focuses on three: the population growth rate, which we have already seen. Then we have the savings rate, which is based on the fact that what every household saves will eventually become an investment. And finally, the technological progress rate, in other words, productivity. This model has the following assumptions. First of all, population grows at a constant rate G, meaning that the future population equals the current population multiplied by this rate. Second, all consumers have the same saving proportion S, which affects directly the consumption equation. Then, all firms have the same production technology function. This function operates with labor and capital as inputs, and A stands for the technology used for them. This function is also assumed to have constant returns to scale, which means that if, for example, labor increased 2 times, output would increase 2 times as well. This leads us to develop our analysis using relative indicators such as output per worker and capital per worker instead of aggregates. Finally, the capital accumulation equation reflects the link between initial capital affected by depreciation and investment. Now, let's move forward with solving the model. The output per worker and capital per worker indicators are shown in Y and K. Those will help us recreate the production function. Taking that the Cobb-Douglas production function is the most common example, we replace those and create our new function. Then, using the income expenditure identity, which tells us that the investment equals savings, we arrive at 2 conclusions. First, the consumer's budget constraint, which is that income equals what we consume and what we save. And also that investment is S multiplied by Y because it equals savings. So we replace that in the capital accumulation equation. Now we put everything together using the capital accumulation function. In order to express it per worker, we add up the population growth rate and replace output per worker with the production function. Solving this, we arrive at the steady state K star, which shows us the point where capital per worker stays constant. This graph reflects 2 curves, the savings rate, which is the blue curve, and the capital accumulation curve, which is the light blue line. The intersection shows us an amount of capital per worker K and output per worker Y that arrive at a steady state. That means that they do not change. So what does this tell us? The main conclusion from the Solow-Swan model states that in the long run, each country will experience a steady state level of economic growth. This is because at first, population growth and savings accumulation rates can increase economic growth, but it's only temporary. For instance, when a country incorporates a second worker on top of its existing one, output rises sharply. However, the addition of 1 worker shows no increase in output when compared to an economy with thousands of workers. After that, the economy expands steadily, with GDP increasing at the same rate as employment and productivity. However, regarding the technological progress rate, technology advancements and innovations are the only factors that can increase the rate of economic growth. This model then justifies how an increase in productivity can stimulate a country's economic growth. This model was essential for us to establish productivity's role in economic growth. But what can make productivity increase? First of all, In order to discuss productivity, we have to focus our analysis in terms of output per worker and capital per worker. The long-run growth of an economy can change the scale of operations by adjusting the level of inputs that are fixed in the short run. An adjustment in input that leads to a higher output per worker stands for an increase in productivity. So, which inputs can be adjusted? Technology or human capital? Let's start with technology. Technology can cause innovations that create an increased level of output with the same inputs. That is what we call an increase in productivity. That could be stimulated through the development of new products, methods, software, materials, and services. Another way would be to improve worker productivity. Worker productivity can increase with investments on capital, for example, better machinery. Now, human capital. What does human capital stand for? Human capital is the amount of skills, knowledge, social skills, and personal qualities, including creativity, that are manifested in the capacity to execute work in a way that generates value for the economy. How can human capital generate higher productivity? By investing on its quality, that is, better education, health conditions, and institutions. When human development is prioritized, it is expected for a nation to make both qualitative and quantitative progress. Which are the most common mistakes? First of all, bear in mind that if we analyze economic growth in the long run, we assume to be in equilibrium. That is, all prices are adjusted. Input prices and final products prices. Remember, productivity stands for relative levels of output. An increase in productivity is not equal to an increase in total output, but an increase in output per worker. So, summing up, we have learned that many factors can stimulate economic growth. In this video, we have focused on productivity. Productivity can play a very important role in a country's economic growth. We went over the Solow-Swan model to justify these concepts. How can productivity increase? By increasing output per worker. This can be done with improvements in technology or investments in human capital. With this, you may understand what long-run growth stands for and how productivity contributes in that matter. So, in this video, we have learned how productivity is crucial for economic growth. Hope you have enjoyed it, and if you want to learn more, please explore more on Chegg.